Eventually, everything wears out. This is a mechanical watch. Every part moves precisely. The spring stores energy to drive the balance wheel that moves back and forth. That moves the escapement, the parts that let the second hand tick forward 1 second at a time. You can see how the little prongs of the escapement rub against its sprocket-like escapement wheel. The parts touch and glide against one another, and eventually the parts will wear out. The watch will fail. Is this the same thing as aging? Is the watch wearing out analogous to a human getting old? I'm Dr. Peter Allen. Now, I'm a bioanalytical chemist during the week, and on weekends I like to make these little explainer videos. Now, I've read the primary literature in the aging field, and I've been to several aging research symposia, so I'm not in the field exactly, but I've listened to what experts have to say, and my interpretation of all that is that aging is pretty different from wearing out as we think of it in the example of the watch. So here's an example of the difference. It'd be easy to imagine that arthritis might be human joints wearing out as we age. We could hypothesize that arthritis is joints aging, kind of like the gears and sprockets wearing out in the watch. But that's not actually what causes arthritis. So in 2009, a medical doctor named Donald Unger won the Ig Nobel Prize for cracking the knuckles of his left hand every day for 50 years. He left his right hand as a control. His mother and his mother-in-law had told him that he would get arthritis in his fingers, so he decided to put that to the test, and he published his findings in the journal Arthritis and Rheumatism. So if arthritis was the result of joints just wearing out over use, the same way that watch parts wear out mechanically, this should have produced clear results. One hand being worked more than the other should have caused a different outcome. Now, it's mostly a joke, of course. Dr. Unger says, tongue firmly in cheek, the results call into question whether other potential beliefs, for example, the importance of eating spinach, are also flawed. Further investigation is likely warranted. This is a study of N equals 1 people. It's not sophisticated. Extremely sophisticated studies with many more detailed experiments, including biochemical measurements, high-resolution imaging, have all shown that rheumatoid arthritis is an immune issue, not a mechanical issue. The roots of rheumatoid arthritis go deep into the relationship between joint cells and immune cells, and you have to study a pretty good amount of biology to even understand how to ask the right questions about what arthritis really is. And the answers are still not entirely known. Now, arthritis is just one example of a disease that progresses with age. Lots of other diseases get worse as we age. So what's really happening? It's not just mechanical wear and tear. One thing that happens as we get older, one mechanism of aging, is that we accumulate so-called senescent cells. Senescent cells are like zombie cells. You see the Kurtzgezagt video if you want. It's in the description. The link is there. It's a great introduction to the whole idea of the mechanisms of aging. Now, senescent cells, as they call them, zombie cells, are not doing their job, but they're not dividing like cancer cells, so that's good. But they are sending out chemical distress signals that are causing problems for the cells around them, so that's bad. When you eliminate the senescent cells in an old mouse, the mouse seems to grow younger. It looks younger, it lives longer, and has shows fewer age-related problems. So we can't use the same strategy in people yet, maybe? So the drug that killed the senescent cells in mice only works in that specific kind of genetically engineered mouse. We need other methods to kill senescent cells that we could try more easily in humans. There are lots of different ways to go about this, and clever scientists are trying all the ones they can think of. So I hope that they get more generous funding. Maybe we should bump the NIH budget up again, huh? So I remember the good old days. They weren't actually all that good, but they were old, when it was a bipartisan success story, one of the few things that everyone could get behind. George W. Bush led the charge to double the NIH budget, and that was good. But I digress. One strategy to kill senescent cells in people is with something called a senolytic vaccination. Sen referring to senescent cells, and lytic for lysis, or breaking open, or killing. The idea is, if senescent cells have some unique marker on their surface, then immune system cells could seek them out and kill them. But the immune system needs to be taught to recognize those senescent cell markers. And they have to be really specific for senescent cells only. If the marker isn't specific enough, the immune system might target non-senescent cells. Now, I'm going to get out the medical jargon here, but in technical language, I believe they call that a bad thing. There is a new paper this year, 2021, by Suda et al. Out of Japan. They use a vaccination in mice against a cell surface marker called glycoprotein non-metastatic melanoma protein B to get immune cells to kill senescent cells. Now that seems to be a marker that is expressed specifically on senescent cells, but also cancer cells maybe, so you know, that's nice. Unfortunately, the Suda paper is behind a paywall, but thankfully an earlier paper is available to everyone. So in that paper, Yoshida et al., also out of Japan, used a vaccine against CD153, another cell surface marker. The basic idea is very similar, so I'll put links in the description to both the papers and some popular press write-ups. Here's the basic idea. Cells are more than just membrane sacs with a nucleus inside. If you could zoom in on the surface, you'd find all kinds of little protein bumps. They all have different purposes. Some are the sensors, some allow the cell to take in nutrients, some connect cells to other cells, but all of these little biochemical bumps can be recognized by other biochemicals. It's like every cell is covered with lots of little keyholes, lots of little locks, and if you have the right key, you can hook on. Vaccines work by activating the immune system. You give the immune system a taste of something so that it will attack that immediately if it shows up again, like a wanted poster. But not a dead or alive wanted poster, it's a kill on sight wanted poster. Now you can activate the immune system for the coronavirus spike protein or the diphtheria toxin or most any other protein, the immune system will then go after it. Now if you can find a specific biochemical on the surface of senescent cells that's not on the surface of other cells, you can make that biochemical and then inject that biochemical with some adjuvants to get the immune system too excited about killing things attached to that biochemical. And once activated to that specific biochemical, the immune system will hunt down and kill senescent cells that carry it. Now we're a long way from human trials, but it seems to have worked reasonably well in mice. The mice lived longer, had fewer age-related degenerative effects, so I'm pretty excited to think that maybe there's a long-lasting method to kill senescent cells in humans someday. Okay, caveat one, mice are not people. Even if something works in mice, it might not work so well in humans. We're gonna have to wait and see. And caveat two, there are the possible autoimmune risks mentioned previously if immune cells start attacking the wrong human cells. And caveat three, when mice had their senescent cells killed off, they had a harder time with wound healing. So maybe senescent cells are involved in some intermediate state in the healing process. Maybe they cause inflammation and facilitate removal of dead cells for regeneration. Maybe that's why we have senescent cells at all. A useful thing to have for wound repair, but has the side effect of slowly accumulating and causing age-related degeneration. Now that leads us to something called antagonistic pleiotropy. Good term, huh? Now pleiotropy is when a single gene has two or more apparently unrelated effects. Antagonistic pleiotropy is when those effects seem to work against each other. So from Wikipedia, antagonistic pleiotropy is when one gene controls more than one trait, where at least one of those traits is beneficial to the organism's fitness early in life, and at least one is detrimental to the organism's fitness later in life. If a gene caused both increased reproduction in early life and degeneration later in life, then senescence would be adaptive in evolution. Put a little more simply, what if being able to make senescent cells helps wound repair, as seems to be supported by the evidence? And if that's true, and young creatures benefit from being able to make those cells, well, they'd be likely to live to adulthood, have kids, and pass on that ability. If childhood injuries are a frequent cause of death, as I think that would have been true in the past, then making senescent cells would be an adaptive trait, a good thing evolutionarily. But a strong version of that trait, being able to make senescent cells quickly and efficiently, might accelerate aging and shorten lifespan. So a shorter lifespan, based on this accumulation, might end up being favored by evolution? It's strange. But we don't have to be satisfied with what evolution has given us. If we find a mechanism for aging, we can work to fight it. So anyhow, thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you next time.